So what about these crops here?
So plant breeding has been a fantastic, fantastic development, which has taken place over the last 10,000 years. It just didn't happen that we started breeding in the last 10 or 15 years. Mankind has been continuously selecting the best and breeding them on. The crops we have today bear no relationship to the crops that these were derived from. So by selecting, by crossing the best with the best in plants, you end up with crops like this. If you take Brussels sprouts, people think they're around for 10,000 years. They're only 300 years old at best. Really? They were derived from the wild cabbage, which came to kale, and then on to the real cabbage, and then to Brussels sprouts in the 1700s, all by conventional plant breeding. And to me, they are similar, except that GM technology allows us to do things that we could never dream about 50 years ago, and that's why they're highly regulated. But it's worth pointing out that to date, we have over 300 million acres of GM crops grown around the world. There hasn't been one single case of an issue with food safety or with nutrition issues or with resistance to various proteins in the crops or whatever. If you take flour, an awful lot of people are celiacs, so they're resistant to a protein in that flour, which comes from wheat. And if I was to say wheat, potatoes, and tomatoes, if we were to put, and they're three world major crops.
Staple foods.
If we were to put them through the regulations that govern GM technology, they would not get on the market. Why? Because some part of the population are subject to the gluten allergy, so it wouldn't get on. Potatoes are related to poisonous weeds, deadly nightshade, as are tomatoes. Tomatoes and potatoes in the same family. And they have relations in here that in the weed form will kill you. But we know that eating potatoes or eating tomatoes won't kill you because we have selected the best for human consumption over years. But I think it's worth pointing out that if we're to put those three crops, wheat, potatoes and tomatoes, through the GM regulations that are governing the technology, they wouldn't get on the market. And to me, that says two things. One, consumers are not aware of the stringent regulations, or two, they don't understand them. And I, for me as a scientist, I think we need to talk about them, let people know they exist. They are probably over the top in reality, and they're favouring big business, which have big, large corporate budgets, over issue. Conventional plant breeders.
Are you saying that big corporations have an advantage now because of that?
Well, yeah, because to get through the regulatory hoops to put a GM crop onto the market, you have to have very big, deep pockets. And only the big multinational companies have those deep pockets.
So when you take some of the big companies that are producing GM, have they not got a monopoly on the seeds and on the patents? And is this not a major threat to us?
Well, it's not a major threat, no. They have a monopoly on the patent. Like if I develop a new patent for any particular new invention, it's open, it's transparent, you can see it. You can go off and try and develop a better patent to overcome it. So I argue that patents, even though they do give a company an advantage to exploit it for 20 years, it's open, it's transparent, there's nothing hidden. So people should not be concerned about patenting of technology. I think what public sector organisations, and we here at UCD, are developing other transformation technologies that would be available to smaller plant breeders. And I think that's the way out of it. Because if you have a patent, you're going to exploit it as best you can. The only way around that is if somebody else can develop an alternative patent that does a similar thing, that we can make it available for public good, then that's one way around that particular problem.
Jimmy, there's a lot of people out there that are concerned about big multinational companies taking control of GM and the seeds and the, if you like, the whole germination of those seeds.
Yeah. Well, while they control the GM technology, they do not own the seeds. There's going to be plenty of germplasm out there in repositories like we have here at UCD, like the Department of Agriculture have, like Chagas have, that can be made available to other plant breeders. So they'll never own the seeds. They'll only ever own their patent or whatever gene they have put into that plant that gives them an advantage. Like, for example, Roundup Ready maize, Roundup Ready soybean. They'll control that because they own the intellectual property on the process of generating these plants. But they'll never own the crop. And they cannot patent a gene. That's already been established. So I think that's a fear that's overhyped. And in my book, that's not a real concern for the future. So, in other words, the regulations that are out there that people are so concerned about governing GM crops should be a major source of reassurance. And the EPA in this country are the regulatory authority that govern the granting of licenses for such crops if they're GM. And if I'm a company, a major company that want to do a trial in Ireland, I have to apply to the EPA, I have to go through a lot of regulations, it's costly, but if I breed conventional varieties that I know are linked to deadly plants, or that it's going to cause a reaction in some celiacs like wheat flour does, then I don't need any license at all. So we have to look at this new technology in a completely different way. And the way I look at it is, people are not even aware of the regulations and how stringent they are, or they don't fully understand them. And this is why it's important to reach out to communities, educate people about the technology, because it is a new science. And people are wary of new sciences. And it's up to scientists like ourselves, people at UCD and elsewhere, to reach out and tell people what we're doing. Because all we're trying to do is develop crops that are more efficient, better against disease, more nutritious, that can help solve the massive global food shortage that's going to take place over the next 20 to 50 years.
In Ireland, Jimmy, are we eating GM foods in Ireland? I know it's banned from Europe, but is it coming in? Is there a certain quantity of it in foods we buy in supermarkets?
There's lots of GM crops coming in. We don't grow them in Europe, although some parts of Europe and Spain and in Eastern Europe, some GM crops are grown. So it's not fair to say that Europe is totally GM-free. It's not. But in Ireland, we import boatloads of GM material every week into the country and have been doing so for the last 20 years. And all the products that are produced from using that material have been on our supermarket shelves for 20 years. And there hasn't been ever any case of an issue with those foods or those plants. So, I mean, the consumer has a choice. We have labelling. It's all on the labels as to whether they're contained or not. But really, from a scientific viewpoint, there should be an awful lot less concern about GM crops than there is currently.
Jimmy, take feedstock for cattle. You know, cattle going in for the winter, they need feedstock. A lot of that is imported. Are there GM parts of that? Or is the maize and the soya, a lot of that not GM?
I mean, the market, first of all, Europe is only 30% self-sufficient in protein. In other words, we don't produce enough protein in Europe for the animal and the people that we have on the planet. So we import it from largely North and South America, which at this stage is 93, 94, 95% GM. So a lot of the protein products that are coming in into this country, and have done for the last 20 years, whether they're gluten or maize distillers or soybean, the majority of them are GM. Now, there is a market developing for non-GM material, because if you're an organic farmer, you cannot use GM under the regulations. I think that has to be looked at, quite honestly, because organic farming is about getting as much disease resistance as you can to protect the plant. And one way of doing it, but it's not going to happen probably in my lifetime, is to use new techniques like the precise tools of GM technology to make organic varieties much more resistant to potato diseases than was heretofore. And like in potato production today, in organic farms, you can apply copper sulfate, which is what we used to do during the war times in the 30s and 40s, the Bordeaux mixture, to try and keep the potato blight down. So it's not to say that organic farmers don't have to control blight. They do. But what you try and do in that case is you look at rotation, you look at the most disease-resistant variety you have, and then you use the copper sulfate where everything else fails. So even in organic farming, we have to control diseases, we have to control weeds, and that's the same across the whole of agriculture. And that's why GM technology is not the panacea, it's not going to solve the world's food problems, but it is a very important tool that's very safe, and we should adopt it, in my view.